Thank you. Hello. Please get seated, get seated. We're about to commence today's program. Please get seated. Get seated. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, the program is about commencing. Audio, reduce your volume. It was so nice seeing the erudite professor, Professor Elochukwu Amuchazi, who just walked in and had gone to sit very close to the national president. What's happening? We don't need echo. We don't need reverberation. We want it natural. We are here this morning because we want to honor one of our own, Elder Senator Ayimude M.O.N., member of the Order of the Niger. As a young broadcaster myself, I met Ayimude more than 35 years ago. From when we were members of trade union organization called RATAO. Ayimude means a lot to so many people, and we are here to honor him. I am not particularly happy about the attendance, but I'm also very optimistic that in no time this hall will be filled to the brim, because indeed today is a very beautiful day, and we have the best of society in terms of the personalities that are already here. People have come from far and wide, and we want to salute those people that have come. As we are getting ready, today's event will be one that will allow us to reflect on the lives we are living, and also look at the man, distinguished senator, Elder Ayimude, the Igbo man from Akeze in Ivo local government area of Ebonyi State. The man who will be laid to rest next week, Friday, pleasing God. And we know it will please God because he left indelible marks in the sand of history. No broadcast journalist worth the name will say that he or she hadn't the opportunity to engage with him as a problem solver, as an administrator, as a good family man, and as a proud Igbo man. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to start recognizing some of our distinguished guests who are here now. We're expecting at least two of the governors of the Southeast geopolitical zone. We're expecting the host governor or his representative, talking about Dr. Barrister Peter Mba, and also his Ebonyi counterpart. But as we're about to kickstart this program, I want to recognize in a very special way the national president of the Nigerian Union of Journalists, Chris Isiguzo, MFR, member of the Federal Republic of Nigeria. Comrade Isiguzo deserves a better round of applause. Why am I saying that? As a broadcast journalist myself, I know what it takes to emerge at that level. It took so long for a Southeasterner to become the president of the Nigerian Union of Journalists. Isiguzo did not just emerge, he became and carved a niche for himself and made us proud, showing the qualities in us as people who can change society for the better. Please clap for him again. Also here present, an early bird, somebody who comes very early, is our distinguished brother. I'm talking about Chief John Nyenwodo Ikuke. A former this, former that, a former president of Ohanaeze Ndigbo, an economist, a lawyer, two-time minister of the Federal Republic of Nigeria. Talking about one of the youngest ministers Nigeria ever had when he served the Shehu Shagari administration as minister for aviation, if I'm right, and later, he became Minister of Information and National Orientation, Ikuke No. We love you, we respect you, because when you talk, you're more eloquent than those who own the language. Whether you're speaking in Igbo or whether you're speaking in English, you've become a model, and we will continue to celebrate you, and we'll continue to pray to God to give you longevity so that we continue to tap from your intellect. You're welcome, sir. So many distinguished Nigerians are here. I am thrilled when I realize that a former president, I don't know if he's the immediate president of the NBA, but I know that I have had cause to meet this man, this very special man, Mr. Oluapata, many years ago, some years back, when because of the mere fact that a young lawyer that worked so hard to ensure that he emerged as national president of the Nigerian Bar Association died in Enugu, somewhere in Ugwu Ajaokunano, where incidentally my mother, who is currently lying in the mortuary, came from. I saw Abata, and he came, spent ample time, and spoke, and made a sad environment to become a worthwhile event. That is why, as a scholar myself, I'd like to commend the Nigerian Union of Journalists and those behind this program the Ayimude family for the choice of Olu Apata as today's guest lecturer. Chief Apata, you're welcome to Enugu once again, sir.
No.
Woke Jureji Numadu. Woke Shirike. Omare Kukwo. Imanandina Sio Ibone Yen Sobu. Bikuku Kenkona no Itapiare. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. There's a man I want to introduce. This man, I will leave that, I will do that later. But I want to introduce Mr. Layola Jayola. What a name. I'm sure I've done well in trying to pronounce it because of my long relationship with people from Eba. I served under so many brothers from Yoruba during my years as a national leader of Radio TV Workers Union, RATAU. So the man I'm talking about is the chief executive officer of the Nigerian Economic Summit Group. You're welcome, sir. He's been here since yesterday, and our brothers have been socializing with him, and we want to thank him for coming. There are many distinguished journalists here today. There are family members also here today. Let me recognize in a special way the pride of the father, the daughter of her father, And I'm talking about Ngozi. I'm talking about Mrs. Nena Ayimokoro. Very delectable, beautiful. This is the kind of woman broadcasters look for to read news on television. Because... Mrs. Okoro, just like the father, is also a very tall personality because currently she is head of consumer client coverage, corporate and investment banking, Stanbic PLC, Nigeria. Madam, you're welcome. You know what I mean? Even at the banking sector. Also in our midst for special recognition is a man some of us had continued to read in communication development, giving what he did as a pioneer head of the Nigeria National Orientation Agency, talking about a professor who gave birth to many scholars and who was able to see a young son became a professor of law, Professor Elochukwu Amuchaze. You're welcome, sir. You're welcome, sir. We thank God who are giving you the strength. No, you're welcome, sir. The person I'm going to introduce now is very special to me. There was a time in my life Enugu was too hot because of my activities as a trade union leader. Then I was national treasurer of the Radio, Television, Theater, Arts Workers Union. At times, I was coming to do a part-time teaching in Esut and go to Abuja to work as assistant national general secretary of the union. Having been thrown out of my job because of my activism and my belief in speaking truth to power all the time. I'm talking about At about a time in my life when I'm expected to be productive as a national leader, but hadn't the environment to do that. Some people expect you to come to Abuja to work without providing you shelter, without providing you hotel accommodation, without providing you anything. It was a time when our union moved from Ring Road, Aziz Aina Street in Ibadan, to Abuja. I'm talking about the man who tried to make life easy for me, who made life very easy, who helped me with accommodation in the then NUJ Hotel anytime. Because if you've been to Abuja and you're not sure of where to sleep, that is the time you will understand that Abuja is tough. I want to recognize for recognition in a very special way, Comrade Malam Shuaibu Leman, National Secretary, Nigerian Union of Journalists, NUJ, Diwale Shadelafia. Shuaibu Leman, you're welcome to Enugu. This is a repository of knowledge, the NUJ archives. Thank you for helping our brother to understand the terrain and to sell seamlessly. We are proud to have you in our midst. Also, cognition is Barrister Ifeanyi Nweke, Vice Chairman, Enugu Sports Club. Yes, representing our brother Victor Atuomu. Am I right? Representing the Executive Chairman. Yes. Victor Atuomu. Thank you. Ken, you're surprised I know these people. Uh-huh. Thank you. Thank you. Professor Bernard Odo, you're welcome. When I talk about Professor Bernard Odo, I talk about a courageous Nigerian. One of the few scholars that dared to venture into politics as ABGA governorship candidate in Ebonyi State. Coming in is the governor of Enugu State, executive governor of Enugu State, talking about Dr. Barrister Pitamba, here ably represented by a man full of erudition, a scholar in his own right, the secretary to the government of Enugu State, Professor Chidiebere Onyia. Una na akwa aka, una na akidukwa aka n'onwa. In fact, mgbe Chidiebere tukugodira nka m ga-eme introduce, because the man who is sitting down now is my brother. Yamich. You are going to have a year today. Professor Chidiebere Onyia, you're welcome, sir. No, one day, Ejibomaru. You're welcome. Nkago Shina program na Chibido, we're expecting the Ebonyi State counterpart, and I'm very sure that he may be on his way now. Earlier, I was talking about Professor Odo Bernard. Professor Odo Bernard, or Bernard Odo, was, as it were, the ABGA governorship candidate in Ebonyi State. He tried. Mani mani ane mene election abo makande marse akwukwo iga ma ekwo jidekwa ego mari ha na eme. Today's program, we're about kicking off because everybody is very busy. And The way this program has been planned, it has been planned to end very shortly. That will not remove the shine from the program because it had been properly planned. So, I want to know if there is any man of God in our midst to lead us in an opening prayer. Somebody who is led in the spirit. But if there's none, I am going to call, without wasting time, the chairman of the Enugu State Council of Nigerian Journalists. Sam, please come and lead us in opening prayer so that we can start this program. Biko, come, the chairman of the Enugu State Council of the Nigerian Union of Journalists. Come and lead us in an opening prayer. Comrade Sam Udekwe.
In the name of the Father, God Almighty, the creator of heaven and earth, God, we thank you for bringing us here today. It is clear you knew we were coming. We've converged on this place, God, because you permitted it. We know also that we are in our midst, because you say, where two or more are gathered, you are in our midst. We are confident, God, the purpose for which we came here today will be fulfilled. It is an honor to whom it is due. Elder Senator Ayimude the late, we are here. God Almighty, may you instill in some of us that are still in the practice to have that spirit of excellence for which Ayimude was known. We are journalists. We are usually exposed to dangers. God, may you use the instrument of today's event to continue to protect us. God, give us the confidence, give us the courage to always do what we are supposed to do. What is right is what we set out to do. We are there for the protection of the voiceless. God, ensure that at the end of the day, nobody lives to regret for doing the right thing. We know that you will lead us through because you have promised that today will be a glorious day as far as this event is concerned. God, this and more we ask thou to do for us in Jesus' name. In the name of the Father.
Amen. Amen. Because we are expecting Kola North, which is going to come from a former vice president with the president himself, to the chairman of today's occasion, Chris Isiguzo, Ken Ofoma, handing over Kola North to Chief Nyanwodo, Ike Nigeria, Ikuke, Dalurine.
Ibane, I want to apologize most profoundly to those who do not understand the Igbo language, because this sacred fruit of ours, with which we bless the name of God in Igbo land, does not understand any other language except Igbo land language. Clearly, everything that we will say in the prayer is to thank God for the very remarkable life that our late father, Senator Ayimude, lived. To thank him for bringing our most distinguished visitors to this gathering, and to pray for your safe journey as you go back, as well as a convivial, meaningful, and beneficial session throughout our stay here. However, the next stage of this procedure It's usually a very controversial one. If I arrogate it to myself to determine it without very serious consultations, I may be visited with terrible sanctions. I will only define the rules as it pertains to this, so that whoever wears the cap can signal to us if he's here, and we will give him the benefit to break the collar knots. Usually when you break collar knots, the collar knot has an eye, which is on a male petal of its various, if you like, parts. And that eye is thrown to the ground. And you don't throw it to the ground where you do not come from. So consequently, whoever breaks and prays with this collar knot must have a filial consanguinity with the land we are situated here, which is also a subject of dispute as to whether it belongs to Nguo or to Nike. Now, I would then ask most gracefully if there is anyone from any of these divides here. If we do not have anyone, we from Enugu State will make a consultation and see who prays with this collar knot. I hope that what I have said is in accordance with our tradition. Well, it doesn't appear there is. I think that our Secretary to Government has a geographical contiguity with the two areas that we have mentioned. So will I ask the Master of Ceremony to take this to him so that he will do us the pleasure of praying. We don't even have time.
I know. Okay. I can get it. Oh, yeah, maybe it's here.
Okay. What? Go on. You will go. I don't want to call permission. Can you hear me buying? Oh, yeah, baby. I work on my day. And we're in here. Well, you know, it's not easier. If we were in my wife's home in Anambra, these collar knots will be distributed to important dignitaries here who represent the various segments of Igbo land before the prayer is said. But we do not do so in our place because the prayer must percolate around the entire knots. It is after the prayer is said that you can begin to distribute them.
Catholic mneje na aja kacha aja na atu eba aja Eucharist.
Thank you very much, Chairman of today's occasion, Chief John Nyanwodo. We have to move very fast now that the opening prayers have been said and call are not broken. I want to invite quickly, because I've been informed that the guest lecturer will be catching his flight also today. So I want to invite in a very special way the chairman, the national president, I beg your pardon, of the Nigerian Union of Journalists, Chris Isiguzo, MFR, to come and give us his welcome remarks. Welcome remarks.
Your Excellency, the Governor of Enugu State, ably represented by the Secretary to the Enugu State Government, the chairman of this occasion, our guest lecturer, very distinguished ladies and gentlemen, permit me to rest on already established protocol. On behalf of the Nigeria Union of Journalists, permit me to warmly welcome all of us to this solemn and momentous occasion as we gather here today to honor the memory of a great individual, Elder Ayim Ude. On behalf of our union, and indeed our esteemed partners, I extend my heartfelt gratitude for your presence here today as we pay tribute to a remarkable leader and also use the opportunity to delve into a topic of utmost significance in our contemporary society. Today we are here to celebrate not just the life of Elder Ayim Ude, but also to engage in a critical discourse on freedom of the press, fake news, and the rule of law. This topic is not only timely but also holds a profound relevance in shaping the future of our nation and the role of journalism in upholding the principles of justice, truth, and democracy. Elder Ayimude was indeed an exemplary figure, a champion of justice, and a staunch advocate for press freedom. His unwavering dedication to the cause of truth and his tireless efforts to defend the integrity of journalism serve as an inspiration to all of us. Today, we remember his contributions, not just to our profession, but to society at large, and we commit ourselves to carry forward his legacy with unwavering commitment and integrity. Throughout his 51-year career in the Nigerian public service, he exhibited unwavering dedication, expertise, and a passion for journalism that inspired generations. As a veteran journalist and broadcast manager, distinguished Senator Ude's contributions were immeasurable. He served as a reporter during the Nigerian Civil War and went on to occupy prestigious positions in various broadcasting establishments, including the Eastern Nigeria Information Service, East Central State Broadcasting Service, Nigerian Television Authority, Imo Broadcasting Service, Federal Radio Corporation of Nigeria, among others. Notably, Elder Ude holds the honor of being the longest serving chief executive in Nigeria's public broadcast industry during his time. His leadership and guidance paved the way for countless journalists and broadcasters, leaving an indelible legacy that will continue to shape the industry for years to come. Beyond his professional achievements, Senator Ude was a community leader, philanthropist, and technocrat who dedicated his life to uplifting others. He exemplified the values of selflessness, integrity, and public service, earning him respect and admiration from all who knew him. Going to the focus of this lecture, the theme of our gathering today, freedom of the press, fake news, and the rule of law, clearly reflects the challenges and complexities we face in the digital age. As journalists and media professionals, we are entrusted with the responsibility of disseminating information accurately and responsibly. However, the spread of misinformation, malinformation, and disinformation, and the rise of fake news have emerged as formidable threats to our profession and the very fabric of our democratic principles. In this pursuit of truth, we must remain steadfast in upholding the principles of objectivity, impartiality, and accountability. As we engage in this dialogue today, let us remember that with freedom comes responsibility. Let us strive to bridge the gap between the digital world and the ethical boundaries that define our profession. I am very confident that the memorial lecture that we're having today, and indeed the lecture itself, which will be delivered by the immediate past president of the Nigeria Bar Association, will be thought-provoking and enlightening. It is my hope that our discussions during this event will not only deepen our understanding of these critical issues, but also inspire collective action to safeguard the integrity of journalism and the rule of law. I extend my sincere appreciations to the local organizing committee for putting this together, and indeed for their unwavering support and collaboration in making this event possible. Today, let us honor Elder Ayimude's memory by reinforcing our commitment to truth, justice, and the principles that underpin a thriving democracy. Once again, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, I welcome each and every one of us to this gathering and wish us all a productive and indeed an enlightening session. Thank you, and God bless us all.
It is my pleasure to welcome Ikuke to make his opening remarks as the chairman of the occasion before we invite the guest lecturer. Ikuke. Welcome, sir.
Your Excellencies, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, I rest on already established protocol. I welcome you all here to this very momentous lecture in memory of a celebrated statesman, a father par excellence, a broadcaster, and a public administrator. It is difficult for me to talk about the subject of today's lecture because he's not just a father, but he was a very close friend to me. I'd like to acknowledge the presence of the Deputy Governor of Ebonyi State, who has just arrived. You're most welcome, Your Excellency. Now, Mrs. Patricia Obila, you're most welcome. I know the guest lecturer is going to say so much, so it is unnecessary to bore you with anything about the subject of this lecturer, except to say that in this generation, we must look back. Chairman of Nigerian Union of Journalists, I thank you for putting this together. But I task you and your colleagues to go back and rediscover what made great men like this. It's not important to say that Senator Anyimude was trained in very good traditions of elementary and secondary education in his times and became a broadcaster. He not only was a broadcaster, he was also versed in writing. And he was also versed in heading broadcasting organizations that straddled the whole part of Eastern Nigeria. But what equipped him to be somebody like that? The professor sitting next to you, we just eulogized, not only for his academic achievements, but for the fact that in his lifetime, his son became a professor. You may say that the apple does not fall too far away from its parent fruit, but I think the system breeds the apple. Let me just give you an example of what my generation went through. I will be 71 this year. I don't know whether it's something to be clapped for because I have no accomplishments at 71. In my native home in Ukehe, my father built 2 secondary schools. I haven't built a primary school. But what is important is that I was born at a time that my father was a member of the Eastern Nigerian House of Assembly. But I started primary education in a rural primary school in Enugu here called St. Patrick's Iva Valley. The only reason I was taken to Iva Valley was that there was a reverend father called Father Michael Eneja, who later became Bishop Michael Eneja, may his soul rest in peace, who was a reputed disciplinarian. The important thing in what I want to dramatize is that my classmate in St. Patrick's Iver Valley was Peter Enejere, the junior brother of my father's driver, James Enejere. There was no school for the minister's child and another one for the driver's child. In contemporary Nigeria, the schools have social stratification. None of you here would have his child in the same school as his driver's child. So beginning from upbringing, from childhood, we already have a compartmentalization of thinking that this is for the have-nots and this is for the haves. I went to College of Immaculate Conception, arguably one of the best schools in southeast of Nigeria, CIC. Two of my classmates were recipients of my father's scholarship. They used to beat me in physics, chemistry, biology, mathematics. I used to beat them in English language, literature, history, Bible knowledge, geography. But I beat them, they beat me in objective subjects, and I beat them in subjective subjects. Consequently, their positions in class were better than mine. And my father chastised me and said to me in Igbo, before I could distinguish myself, we had branched into our areas of natural endowment. And one of them went to become an engineer. The other one went to become a sociologist. And I went to become an economist. Now, but if I go back to CIC, I remember everything that I was taught there as if it was yesterday. But I left CIC 52 years ago. I'm an economist and a lawyer. But I can tell you, all the books we read in science, Nelcon, physics was written by Nelcon, chemistry was written by Holderness and Lambert, mathematics was written by Cannon and Smith, Stone and Cousins wrote biology. If I go into the chemistry lab now, I can tell you all the apparatus, beginning from the test tube, the beakers, the strips that we use to test for litmus, the Bunsen burner. I can tell you the combustion of the Bunsen burner called the striking back of the Bunsen burner. I can tell you the experiments of oxidation, reduction, double decomposition, lateral displacement, radical crystallization. Don't clap for me. Moan for yourself. My own children were examined in school certificate in what is called alternative to practical. I'm happy that people in government are here. The task before you is enormous. If you breed a society divided according to how much you can access education, depending on how much you have, you are a failure. Today, we've come to extol a man who was not a failure because he helped to build a society that did not determine your economic background before he gave you the training. Before he mentored you, he taught by example. Distinguished Senator Anyimude is a worthy example to follow. And I welcome you all for coming here to give tribute to him. And I have no doubt in my mind that my friend and brother, Olu Akpata, will give justice to this lecture. You're most welcome. Thank you for your...
It will be difficult not to acknowledge the speech, the opening remarks of the chairman of today's occasion. Please, let's give him another round of applause. It is at this juncture that I humbly welcome to the podium today's guest lecturer, guest speaker, former this, former that, immediate past president of the Nigerian Bar Association, Mr. Olu Akpata. You're welcome, sir.
Thank you so much.
Yes, and there's actually, we have a citation on him, but for want of time, we want to go straight to the main meal. And for your information, you can look at the program, which I'm sure every attendee here is having, to look at that citation. You're welcome, sir. We're all students now because the subject matter is extremely important.
Thank you. His Excellency, the Governor of Enugu State, my friend, my brother, Mr. Peter Ombah, ably represented by the Secretary to the State Government, our most distinguished professor. You're most welcome, sir. Her Excellency, the Deputy Governor of Ebonyi State, you're most welcome, ma'am. My adopted father, you are emblematic of that which we aspire to be, sir. Chief John Nyawodo, I count it a privilege and honor to call you friend, sir. I am so grateful that you have put me in that bracket or in that group of people who can be called your friends. I thank you, sir, for being you, for being the beacon that you continue to be in a blighted, very blighted society that we have come to find ourselves in. Continue being yourself, sir, and God bless you. The Ayimude family, I will, as we say in Christianese, I will use as a point of contact to the family, my brother, Nana, and my sister I just met this morning, Nena. Thank you for having me here. Let me single out for mention, because we must give honor to whom it is due. Our father who is here with us, Professor Amuchiazi, who is the father of my friend, also Professor Amuchiazi, Senior Advocate of Nigeria. Thank you, sir. President of the Nigerian Union of Journalists, my dear brother, Mr. Siguzo, good to meet you, see you again. I would also mention Chief Executive Officer of the Nigeria Economic Summit Group, Mr. Jayola, my brother. I single the Economic Summit Group out for mention because I've been part of that group for over, 20 years. We've been doing, it's a think tank that refused to accept Nigeria the way we have found it. NESG is a think tank that over the years, despite the odds, swimming against the tide, has continued to believe that a new Nigeria is possible. Long before that became the mantra of some other groups, the NESG has continued to engage private sector and public sector to bring about a new Nigeria. And I continue to wish you well, in spite of the daunting, very daunting odds that you face. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, I consider it an honor to have been called upon to deliver what I hope will be the first of many memorial lectures organized by the Nigerian Union of Journalists in honor of Senator Elder Ayimude, member of the Order of the Niger, who passed on to greater glory on Monday, the 15th of May, 2023. While it is certainly not in my place to read the profile or deliver an eulogy for the late senator at today's event, it would be remiss of me not to mention that the senator belonged to that exclusive class of Nigerians who lived their lives for the country and who are unfortunately going into extinction at a rapid and alarming rate. As we know, Senator Ude left a solid track record of public service spanning over 5 decades and served Nigeria meritoriously in different capacities. For our present purposes, the most important of the capacities in which Senator Ude served his fatherland was his role in the media as a veteran journalist and a broadcaster. Senator Ayemude holds the exclusive distinction, as we have been told, of being the longest serving chief executive in Nigeria's public broadcasting industry, after serving for 16 and a half years as chief executive of several broadcasting establishments in Nigeria. Of course, he was a member of the Nigerian Union of Journalists. I must therefore begin this address by commending the NUJ, especially the NUJ leadership and the NUJ Memorial Lecture Organizing Committee for doing me this honor, this honor to one of its own. I must also express my gratitude to the NUJ, as well as the family of Senator Ude, for finding me worthy of delivering the memorial lecture. But I must also do something I normally do before I forget, before I get into the meat of the lecture. It's always a delight to be in the eastern part of my country. I love my country. The chairman talked about when he was in school, and school was a leveler. Yes, Mr. Chairman, sitting next to me on my right was the driver of the school bus, his son. And on the left was the lady who supplied bread to the school in my class. And in front of me was General Obasanjo's son. So we were all in school. But the good thing about our school also was that there was everybody from everywhere in Nigeria. So whenever I come to the East or any part of Nigeria, I'm always at home, because that was what we fostered in times of yore. Today, the so-called Unity Colleges, if you go to FGC Warri, you only find Warri people there and Ugeli people there. Or if you go to FGGC Benin, it is the girls from Benin and Ekpoma who are there. In those days, sir, if you tried to go to King's College and you didn't make it, you try for Sokoto. If you get Sokoto, you get on a train, or you get on a bus, or you get on a plane, and you go to Sokoto. Your parents dispatch you at the airport. Nobody was worried that you won't come back. That was the country, at least. My generation, we got a whiff, a sense of what the dream was, which is why I'm always happy. I'm comfortable in any part of the country. So, before I continue with my speech, let me greet you. Ndewo. Thank you for having me. Dalorinne. So I will proceed. Haven't I established that I'm, as we say, Nkabukai? Speaking of the Ayemude family, I think I should make this confession. I have known Nana for a long time, his son, and we have become very close friends. Those who know me know that I am a sucker, as the Americans say, for intellect and hardworking, people who are hardworking. And once I discover such people, they become my friends forever. And then I saw discipline, dedication, and a particular work ethic that I identified with. And I realized that this is one friend I was going to keep. Which is why when he called me to be here today, he knows I'm meant to be on a flight tonight. It's 50-50. I probably can't make that flight out of the country tonight. But, you know, relationships make the world go round. That sacrifice Nana is worth making. That's why I'm here today. On the other hand, I did not know the late senator at close quarters. And I did not actually make the connection for a long time that I was Nana's dad. But when I finally did, my reaction was no wonder. Looking back now, it is clear to see that the discipline, dedication, and hard work that Nana effortlessly exhibits and demonstrates is actually reflective of his upbringing and the lessons he must have imbibed from his father. As the saying goes, and as Mr. Chairman mentioned earlier today, the apple does not fall too far away. I was going to say it's tree, but Chairman actually said I will remember, Chairman, you couch it differently. Anyway, let me stop talking about Nana before my new sister Nana gets jealous. So let's move on. But I just said this to say this. Thank you for doing your father proud. I was asked to deliver a lecture on the topic Freedom of the Press, Fake News, and the Rule of Law. The NUJ Organizing Committee, however, unfortunately for them, accorded me the license to make necessary adjustments to the topic. At first glance, any curious mind in the room may wonder why a lawyer, or better yet, a member of the Nigeria Bar Association, should be delivering the memorial lecture organized by the NUJ in honor of a veteran journalist and broadcaster. We often hear of the need for unity amongst the various tribes in Nigeria or ethnic groups, or the need for adherents of the various faiths in Nigeria to live together in unity. We hear about this. But invitation to deliver today's lecture, I willingly accepted. And it is in this regard that I urge us all to join me as we x-ray that relationship. Holding their feet to the fire. The role of the press and the law in the development of Nigeria in a fake news era. In discussing the above topic, I hope you can all understand that the only way I can do justice to the topic is to tell some home truths today, however unpalatable. I read to you a quote I saw on Twitter. President Tinubu needs to address the nation now. Hunger is walking on the streets of Nigeria. Somebody put that on Twitter on Tuesday. And it aptly encapsulates the grim situation that is currently pervading Nigeria. Instructively, this publication was made even before the news became public that the pump price of petrol has increased again to 617 naira per liter. There is one thing with which majority of Nigerians agree, irrespective of religion or ethnic background. Nigeria has not yet lived up to expectation, having regard to its abundant human and natural resources. By all economic indications, Nigeria is still punching way below its weight category. Let me give you some depressing stats. The World Poverty Clock records Nigeria as the country with the highest number of persons, nearly 90 million, living in extreme poverty. An unwanted feat that we attained after overtaking India. Meanwhile, the population of India is almost 7 times that of Nigeria. The last employment data from the Bureau of Statistics puts Nigeria's unemployment rate at an all-time high of 33%, with almost 65% of our youth either unemployed or underemployed. Everything points to the fact that the current rate is because the statistics I'm giving you are a bit dated, the current rate of unemployment is higher than that. Furthermore, although Nigeria is regarded as the largest economy in Africa, with a GDP of around $500 million, a closer look at the practical macroeconomic indices reveals that this does not necessarily impact on the bottom line of the average Nigerian. For instance, Nigeria is not in the top 15 of highest per capita income in Africa. Further, Nigeria's inflation rate is higher than the average for Africa, African and sub-Saharan African countries, And it is public knowledge that Nigeria's economy has been fluctuating in and out of recession in the past few years. Not too long ago, our former Minister of State for Education, Chukwuemeka Nwajuba, was reported to have said that Nigeria has the highest number of out-of-school children, over 10 million, in sub-Saharan Africa. Another unwanted statistic comes from the UNICEF, and it reveals that one in every five of the world's out-of-school children is in Nigeria. UNICEF further claims that even though primary education is officially free and compulsory in Nigeria, about 10.5 million of the country's children aged 5 to 14 years are not in school. Only 61% of our 6 to 11-year-olds regularly attend primary school, and only 35.6% of children aged 36 to 59 months receive early childhood education. Let me make you feel worse. Nigeria's infrastructure deficit is so high that it is widely accepted to be one of the biggest factors holding back the country's growth and development. While there have been different projections, the immediate past Secretary of Government, Boss Mustafa, stated recently that about $2.3 trillion is needed to bridge the infrastructure deficit in Nigeria over the next 22 years. This is not forgetting the burden of the humongous domestic and foreign debt that Nigeria is currently grappling with. This has also not considered the seemingly intractable issue of insecurity. The foregoing represents a sneak preview of the many challenges that Nigeria face on a regular basis. All of these point to a fact that is generally known. Nigeria has long suffered a leadership crisis across all levels of government. An illustrative example that immediately comes to mind is how government bungled the currency redesign policy of the Central Bank of Nigeria and by itself unleashed untold and unprecedented hardship on the citizenry. For the media, all of these call for a little introspection. What did the media do? What is the media doing? Let me look at the Nigeria Bar Association before I talk about the media. As many of you here know, I was until about a year ago the president of the Nigeria Bar Association, in which role I served as the spokesperson of that association. Prior to assuming that role, I was worried about what had become of our noble profession, and especially what had become of the association that we had all grown up to admire. At that time, the NBA had lost its voice as the prime defender of the integrity and independence of the bar and the judiciary. I therefore promised in my campaign manifesto that my administration shall strive diligently and consistently to restore the dignity of the bar. I pledge that under my watch, the voice or opinion of the bar must and will be heard or rendered loud and clear on every topical issue, policy, action, etc., of various governments, their agencies, and other issues of national and global discourse. In other words, I promise to speak truth to power. I will allow you and posterity to be the judge of whether or not, and to what extent, we achieve this aspect of our promise. I said earlier that the relationship between lawyers and journalists is characterized more by similarities than differences. I have for long known that lawyers, journalists, and organized labor have what you may call a somewhat divine mandate of holding governments to account in a way that other professionals do not seem to have. When governments contravene the Constitution or introduce policies that let loose hardship and suffering on the citizenry, or when things generally go wrong in society, The people do not turn to the medical doctors or to the engineers to say or do something about it. They call on the press. They call on the MBA. And of course, they expect the opposition to speak up. The media, both mainstream and now new media, was awash with the role that the MBA played during the NSAS mini revolution that swept across the country in October of 2020. Very few people knew the pressure I came under as president of the MBA to respond to the various cries for help from people whose families and friends were arrested and or detained by the various security agencies. I do not believe that architects or the president of the NIA or the president of the NSE faced similar pressure. Before 2020, ladies and gentlemen, it appeared that the lawyers and the MBA had decided to gag themselves or otherwise restrain or constrain themselves from playing their God-given role. Literally, every lawyer kept referencing to the golden era of my illustrious predecessor, Alao Akabashonu, a former president of the MBA. Yet no one seemed willing to take the hard decisions needed to ensure that the MBA lived up to expectations. We were content with going cap in hand to governments, especially state governments, to organize even our smallest events, statutory events like our National Executive Council meetings. We will go and beg governors and ministers for money to fund the MBA. The resultant effect was obvious. The MBA became conflicted and beholden to this government. I recognized early in my administration that we had to do things differently if we were to achieve our goals. We therefore spent those 2 years trying to rebuild our association and to restore the MBA to the critical role of an independent watchdog for society, even if it meant spending our scarce resources and foregoing those donations from government patronage that would have made our work easy. I will use 4 examples to drive home the point. A few days after I was sworn in as president, as the 30th president of the MBA, we woke up to the news of the reported amendment of the rules of professional conduct by the Honorable the Attorney General of the Federation. The purported amendments had far-reaching implications on the workings of the MBA and indeed the administration of justice in Nigeria. Without mincing words, it was obvious that the widely publicized amendments were targeted at crippling the MBA and to sabotage our efforts to perform our role as watchdog of society. Perhaps the manner of my emergence as MBA president and my no-holds-barred approach has sent signals in some quarters that it was not going to be business as usual. Right from when the story broke, our initial approach was to make efforts to resolve the issue with the Attorney General. But our efforts did not yield the desired results, and we were left with no choice but to approach the courts for a judicial determination of the issue. Anyone who knows how the legal profession works will recognize that in Nigeria, you really do not want to tangle with the Honorable Attorney General. Yet we sued and we won, and he did not appeal. On the 1st of February 2021, the former Inspector General of Police, Mohammed Adamu, attained the maximum 35 years of service. Rather than accept his resignation and replace him, former President Muhammadu Buhari controversially announced the extension of the tenure of the IGP by 3 months. While the MBA had nothing pecuniary to gain from the retirement or elongation of the tenure of that gentleman, and indeed at a time when it was not fashionable to challenge the former president, the MBA commenced an action before the Federal High Court, Lagos, to challenge the tenure extension on grounds that the purported extension was outside and in excess of the provisions of the Constitution of the Federal Republic of Nigeria. I am sure Many of you will recall the ban on Twitter by the Buhari government on the 4th of June 2020, simply because the government did not take kindly to the former president being censored by Twitter following his comments on the Biafra agitation. We did not fold our arms or use the opportunity to get on the good side of the government of the day. Far from it. On the same night that the Twitter ban was announced, I issued a statement condemning the ban as an attempt to stifle the free speech guaranteed by the Constitution. We did not stop at that, but also filed an action before the Federal High Court, Lagos, to challenge that ban. My last example comes from closer home. Some of you may recall that on the 8th of March 2022, the Federal High Court in Abuja, Quorum Honorable Justice Iyangekwo, delivered a judgment in which the court, inter alia, ordered their excellencies, former governor of Ebonyi State, Dave Umahi, and his deputy, Eric Kelechi Igwe, to vacate the offices of governor and deputy governor, respectively, on grounds of their defection from the People's Democratic Party to the APC. Following the judgment, Governor Umahi, in the course of a press conference, threw caution to the wind and deployed very uncomplimentary adjectives and intemperate language in characterizing both the judgment and Honorable Justice Ekwo, including but not limited to describing the judgment as jungle justice and that his lordship was a hatchet man. As if these were not enough, Engineer Umahi accused the governor or the court of murdering justice and declared the judgment of a court of competent jurisdiction as null and void, all by himself, while unashamedly declaring his intention to disregard the judgment in favor of another. Immediately after that, in a manner that showed that the MBA and I had no personal interest in the matter other than in upholding the rule of law and ensuring respect for our cherished judiciary, the MBA excoriated the governor and demanded an immediate apology from him, which he tendered. These are just a few examples of what the MBA under my administration was able to achieve simply because we resolved to do things differently. I am here today to challenge you to resolve to do things differently as journalists. As I have learned, the seeming futility by which I mean, you might ask me what happened in court in those matters that we instituted. Oh, where did he get you? You might ask me, did he achieve anything? The seeming futility of doing things right in Nigeria cannot be the reason for not doing the right things. The opposition. I said earlier that to ensure that governments are constantly held accountable, that responsibility falls on civil society led by labor, the lawyers, and the press. Another group of people who owe Nigerians that responsibility is the opposition. For long, just like there was a vacuum in civil society, there was also a huge vacuum in the opposition. As far as I am concerned, over the years, the dominant parties, APC and PDP, have demonstrated or exhibited that they are two sides of the same coin. Nigerians therefore yearned for a truly alternative platform to express themselves. That is what democracy is all about. Without this, democracy cannot fully develop. So, lawyers, the journalists, labor, and opposition, it is that combination that keeps us going. Otherwise, we're going nowhere. So, even though he's not here now, we must give credit to His Excellency Peter Obi and all of those in the Labour Party, because as far as I'm concerned, they have led the charge. They have helped us see to the emergence of an opposition, a platform where people power can be demonstrated. And that is necessary for the survival of any democracy. So now, I can now turn to the NUJ. As I said, when I received the invitation to deliver this lecture, I asked myself a number of questions. And some of those questions included, what happened to journalism in Nigeria? What happened to investigative journalism? Why are you not holding government to account? Why are you not holding their feet to the fire? What happened to the profession practiced with distinction by the likes of Dr. Nnamdi Azikiwe, Peter Enahoro, Chris Anyanwu, Ernest Ikoli, Dele Giwa, Tunde Thompson, Ndoka Irabo, Uncle Sam Amuka, Olabisi Onabanjo, Olusegun Osoba, and of course, Senator Ayim Ude, who we are gathered here today to honor. Without intending to be unnecessarily critical, even the most optimistic practitioner of journalism in Nigeria would admit to himself or herself that this is not the finest hour for the profession. Why then are you content to having your noble profession diminished and dismissed with sobriquets like brown envelope profession? Are we saying that there are no noble and upright men or women in the profession who are appalled by the actions of a few people who are soiling the profession? To what extent are you willing to go to restore the pride of your profession? I am not oblivious of the factors that significantly inhibit the practice of journalism in Nigeria, particularly investigative journalism, including the fact that we have low salaries, bad working conditions, corrupt practices by journalists, and client, what I call clientelism. There are also, but these are also some of the challenges that the MBA faced, that other organizations face. And indeed, during my administration as MBA president, I faced some of these challenges. But I said earlier, we resolved to do things differently. There have been actions and events in the past few years that you would have expected the press to rise up against. But what we saw was, at best, haphazard reactions, and in some cases, total deafening silence. An example is, frankly, the disgraceful episode right at the twilight of the Buhari administration, when under the guise of launching so-called Nigeria Air, a legacy project of the Buhari administration, the former aviation minister, Hadi Sirika, is said to have chartered an Ethiopian airline aircraft with registration number ET-APL, which was draped in the colors of Nnamdi, made to fly to the Nnamdi Azikiwe International Airport, Abuja, with attendant fanfare, only for the aircraft to be returned to Ethiopian Airlines and to be repainted in Ethiopian Airline colors to continue his scheduled flights. A few weeks later, Dakpo Olumide, the acting managing director of Nigeria Air, admitted to the Senate Committee on Aviation that the airline was yet to secure an operating license for full flight. In other words, Nigerians had been scammed. Yet, there was no sustained indignation or angst from Nigerians or from the press. Another example is the confession of Senator Adamu Bokachua at his valedictory Senate session on the 10th of June, 2023, where he told a shocked nation, indeed he admitted to the commission of a crime, that he was able to His wife permitted him, his wife, by the way, is the outgone or retired president of the Court of Appeal, Zainab Bokachua, that she allowed him interfere in her judicial functions to curry or to obtain favors for his colleagues. He was informing his colleagues as they were telling each other bye-bye. Remember what I did for you. I got my wife to intervene or to help you in your matters. He was able to spill the beans before he was tactfully asked to shut up by the Senate President, Ahmed Lawan, who himself is the beneficiary of a shocking judicial victory. So much so that Rochas Okorocha had to implore him to teach them in the Senate how he, Lawan, managed to return to the Senate without contesting invalid primaries. What did the UJ do? I'm a member of the National Judicial Council. I was absent at a meeting of the council where the NJC, the regulator of the judiciary, decided that it will say nothing about the Bokachua spectacle. So at the next meeting of the NJC, where I was in attendance, under AOB, I asked the chairman of the council, who happens to be the chief justice of the federation, that I just needed clarity, that what I have heard from my colleagues and read from the minutes, that is correct, that this body has decided to keep mum in the face of this shocking revelation. And that if that was the case, I wanted to inform the council that all of Nigeria is aghast, that the people are in shock, and that the people will tar all of us with the same brush, and that our silence will be taken as acquiescence, and that we will be taken to be collaborators in this unfortunate spectacle where a senator told the world that he committed a crime in collusion with his wife, the outgone president of the Court of Appeal. One member of the council said to me that I was not at the last meeting. Why am I bringing it up? I said, what has my absence at the last meeting got to do with the issue at hand? You must understand, ladies and gentlemen, we are dealing with judges. In my profession, we don't talk back to judges. But you must speak up. There are times when you really can't shut up any longer. I said to him, my lord, what has my absence got to do with the issue at hand? And he said, this matter is closed. We are not from the streets here. I said, I beg to differ. I am from the streets. I wear that badge with pride. It is what is happening on the street that is most important, not what is happening in this hallowed or these chambers that we have created for ourselves. What are the people saying? It had been suggested at the NJC that at the minimum, the NJC should report the matter either to the police or to the ICPC so that we demonstrate to the people that we are not part of this nonsense. But their lordships, they refused. Nothing to see here, move on. There's no corruption. And the Chief Justice of Nigeria, Chairman of the Council, said to me that that is indeed the decision of the NJC. And I said, thank you, my lord. I just needed clarity so that I, as a member of this body representing the Nigerian Bar Association, I know what to do to distance myself from this, what I will call unfortunate decision. We must speak up. We must speak up. What is the press doing? How did we become so desensitized? How did we become so jaded that what would be heinous crimes in other crimes is taken as par for course? That's so it be. I won't do nothing to. It's a broken system, and everybody is in line waiting to be the next beneficiary of that broken system. What is the press doing? In the words of Sam Nwankwo, I hope I got that right, a deputy editor at the Nigerian Tribune, and this is just for me to let you know that not everybody in the press kept quiet. He says, that Senator Bokachua's confession of June 10, 2023 should ordinarily cause collective bawling, B-A-W-L-I-N-G, in several quarters of our country. It was about the worst form of mud that our national life has been dragged through. But we tend to be shameless when we should hide our faces. We are not even alarmed. This is what Sam said. Regrettably, the views of Sam represents only an exception rather than the widespread condemnation. How many people read the Tribune? Only an exception rather than the widespread condemnation from the press that one would have expected. has such a revelation come from a public office in another country? To date, no one has been brought to book. Anyone who is in doubt as to the extent and of the powers and influence of the press in a democracy should just think back to the Watergate scandal. Remember Bob Woodward of the Washington Post and his colleagues that ultimately led to the resignation of Robert Nixon in 1974. Bob Woodward is still practicing journalism till today. He's still shaking tables till today. I am sure the veterans amongst you will remember the roles that he played. Do we have the equivalent today in Nigeria? Unfortunately, I hate to be the harbinger of bad news. The verdict is that journalism in Nigeria has flatlined, as the Americans would say. It would appear that you have closed shop and that journalism in Nigeria has become, at best, influence peddling and, in its worst form, blackmailing. I recall an example of a journalist who recently called me, lawyer journalist, because as I will speak to the later, you know, because of the abdication, everybody is now a journalist, because those who should be journalists are not doing what they should do. So everybody calls themselves journalists now. So a lawyer journalist called me and said that can I send him a few paragraphs to congratulate our colleague, Senator Godswill Akpabio, on his emergence as president of the Senate. And I said to him, I still have a problem with his emergence as a senator. Why are you asking me to congratulate him? Let me still process how he emerged as a senator. Then come back and ask me later. He said, Presido, what's it don't happen. I said, no, not in my book. Not in my book. There's something wrong with the process where we shift goalposts in the middle of a game. It's wrong. So if the best that I can do in my own corner is not to issue letter of congratulation, let it be that that's what I did. I will not congratulate until I'm convinced that the individual should be where he is. Respected journalists, members of the NUJ, as we often say, nature abhors a vacuum. Because now I want to speak to the issue of fake news. Nature abhors a vacuum. The cost of the death of investigative journalism in Nigeria is that citizen journalists, through smartphones and social media, have taken over the roles that should be performed by mainstream media. You know, as they say in Wari, where I grew up, now war went for, now ain't let goat climb up. And you all know that fake news will definitely abound when those who have not received the proper training now begin to walk the streets and declare that they are journalists. There's a tendency for irresponsible journalism. No fact checking. And anything goes in an attempt to deliver what we all now know as breaking news. So, these citizen journalists who are not exposed to the same training that you have gone through, and they did not undertake to subscribe to any code of ethics, are the journalists that Nigerians listen to now and turn to for their news. I must admit that it is not all gloom and doom, and there are still many flashes of brilliance. Members of the press who still strive to shake tables and live by the code of conduct of the NUJ. In this regard, I must let you know that I turn to Arise TV more these days than I used to, because I find that there is an independence of thought and there is courage of conviction from that news platform. In drawing to a close, let me tell you that I particularly personally found succor in the words of the preamble to the Code of Ethics for Journalists in Nigeria, which I have taken the liberty of reproducing in part. Journalism entails a high degree of public trust. To earn and maintain this trust, it is morally imperative for every journalist and every news medium to observe the highest professional and ethical standards. In the exercise of these duties, a journalist should always have a healthy regard for the public interest. Truth is the cornerstone of journalism, and every journalist should strive diligently to ascertain the truth of every event. Ladies and gentlemen, there's anger and there's hunger in the land. It has already found expression in different forms, including the NSAS movement, the obedient movement. I always tell lawyers to remember, during NSAS, the protesters went to Lagos Island. They skipped the Federal Ministry of Works. They skipped King's College. They went to the Lagos High Court. They burnt it down. You remember the image of that chap who came out wearing the robes of a judge and the wig and wielding a machete and holding a book. Spoke volumes. They see the courts as the courts of injustice, not justice. There's a fine line between man and animal. You and I, we all know our basal instincts. We know how we struggle daily to suppress them. But when a man cannot feed himself or his family, when Gary becomes luxury, that line would easily be crossed. And I must tell you that when the line is crossed, they will not be able to make their way to Abuja. They will make their way to my home and your home. And they will ask us, what did we do when they were gang-raped by a succession of leaders? What did we do? So, I turn again to the group, that group of persons in whose hands we can find a solution. Three groups: the lawyers, the journalists, and the labor unions. And I also added in the course of this address the opposition. The time to act is now. And let that not be an over hackneyed cliche. It's not a cliche. At least in my lifetime, I don't think I have seen things so bad. The time to act is now. So in the way that I started, let me again commend the Nigerian Union of Journalists for putting this together. In honor of a great man, let me commend the family for collaborating with the NUJ to honor your father. I formally commiserate with you, and I pray that Almighty God will grant his soul eternal rest. And just to show off my Igbo again, I say, my smattering of Igbo, I say, Dalurinne, and Ekene Dili Chukwu.
I'd like to get. He deserves a standing ovation. The guest speaker, Mr. Olumide Akpata, spoke truth to power. His lecture was full of erudition, illuminating, it is timeless, And we want to thank him in a very special way. Cameraman, remember we have governors here in our presence. Before we will begin to ask some people to come and say one or two things in terms of questions, it is my pleasure to quickly call on the governor of Enugu State, who is here ably represented by the secretary to the government of our state, to come and make a few remarks. Here and now, I want to call Professor Chidi Ebere Onya to the podium. Your Excellency, sir.
His Excellency, the Governor of Ebonyi State, ably represented by the Deputy Governor, Her Excellency Princess Patricia Obilia Onyeichi, forgive me, the Chairman of the occasion, my big brother, mentor, John Nyangwodo. It's nice to see you again, sir. The guest lecturer and former MBA president, Mr. Olu Agbata. Brilliant, brilliant lecture. Brilliant lecture. Brilliant lecture. Throughout the lecture, I forgot to check my phone if I had any emergency. That's how engaging it was. Thank you so much. The national president, NUJ, Chief Chris Isiguzo, MFR. It's always an honor, 2 times in 4 weeks. That's a blessing, right? Thank you, it's nice to see you again. The acting chairman, Igbo Leaders of Thought, Barrister Elochukwu Amuchiaze. It's an honor meeting you, sir. The CEO Nigerian Economic Summit Group, Mr. Jayola. The national secretary, NUJ, Malam Usman Shaibu, Mr. Nana Anyim Ude, and the sister, Mrs. Nena Okoro, Ni Anyim Ude, and the other family members here. Nana, I'm here in two capacities, to represent His Excellency and as your friend and your brother. The Enugu State Chairman, NUJ, Comrade Sam Udekwe, and other journalists here present, gentlemen of the press, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. I bring you greetings on behalf of His Excellency, Dr. Peter Mba, who would have been here, Nana knows what happened, he's out of town, and I'm here to represent him. He brings greetings of Ndi Enugu to everybody here that is visiting, especially our brother, the keynote speaker that said a few words in Igbo, very remarkable. Dalunu Ekene Delichukwu. So before you leave today, I'll teach you another one. But I'll tell you off camera, okay? All right. So our brother, Nana, His Excellency would have wanted to share this with you himself, and I'm sure he will call you later. Just to say, I hadn't met your father before he passed, but I do remember clearly my experience with you. And I was told the line the guest speaker had taken in trying to reflect on the type of man he was, and also listening to the chairman, Chief Nyangwodo, describing your father. And I will say that I recall clearly the first time I met you, Nana. It was a meeting with my team. I wasn't supposed to be there, and a few things needed my decision on how to move forward. And I joined that meeting. And I had planned to be in that meeting for about 5 minutes to make the decision and step out. And it was in the conversation I ended up speaking and staying an hour because of the nature of the conversation and the quality of thought process that came out from you. So the tenacity in able to hold very, very complicated conversations over a period of time to get to a result is what the chairman had talked about when he mentioned your father. And it's a remarkable thing to see a transition of eloquence, brilliance, and the level of tenacity you have exhibited over the years in the work you've done in helping Nigeria move from where we should be in terms of the way we think about development, the way we hold one another accountable, and more important, the way we celebrate success. Seeing all that depicted in you is an example of what your father did when he was involved in public practice. So I commend your father. I commend your family. I see your sister, I see your siblings, and I know that what is left in you is another legacy that is going to go to another generation. And I do say today that God will continue to give your family strength. It's not easy to lose somebody like your father, but he left a legacy in you and your sister. And I'm sure that, yes, we will miss him, but what he represents, the value he represents, is still going to continue with you and in you. So on behalf of the government of Enugu State, I say we are truly sorry for the loss, but we celebrate the life of the man. And I thank you for having me here. And then now I've spoken on behalf of the governor, I'll speak on behalf of myself. Thank you so much for having me. You're a great man, and we'll continue to talk later. I'll call you, but I have to run now for another meeting. God bless you. God bless your family. And for all those that have come, thank you so much for coming to Enugu State. I hope you enjoy yourself. And more importantly, for you to continue to do some of the key things that the keynote speakers talked about, which is just doing things differently in an era where the norm has become this level of complacency and the mediocrity of thinking that has plagued us and resulted to where we are today. So keep us in your prayers, those that have the few opportunity to be able to make a difference, that while we're here, that we'll also leave a legacy so that someday somebody will sit down and say, we did something different. So thank you and God bless you.
Unuko ole akano akwanu governor. Yes, yes. Before His Excellency leaves, there's going to be a national anthem because I know he's going to leave shortly because of his busy schedule. Okay, sorry. Thank you. Oh, it's protocol, people. Okay, sorry. That's very correct because of the presence of Obila, yes. The SSG representing the governor of Enugu State is already exchanging pleasantries, not just with the family of the Udays, but other people. Here we have our brother, our father, Professor Elochukwu Amuchiaze, Secretary, Igbo Leader of Thought, and former DG, National Orientation Agency. Oh, Mamsa that later became this. Not yet time, sir. We are going to invite you formally, but not now, sir. Your Excellency, thank you for coming. We are happy you came. We listen to you with rapt attention. It is my pleasure now to quickly invite his Ebonyi State counterpart, the governor of Ebonyi State, who is here ably represented by Princess Patricia Obila. Her Excellency, Princess Obila, you're welcome to Enugu, the coal city. No.
Thank you so much, sir. The governor of Enugu State, Dr. Peter Umba, represented by the XIG. The national president of Nigerian Union of Journalism, of journalists, Chief Chris Isu Guzo, my own brother, God bless you. The chairman of this occasion, the guest speaker, Mr. Uluomo Akbata, God bless you. Olumide, don't worry, I will explain that name when I get there. I know what I'm doing. God bless you. Let me stand on the already established protocols. Yes, our brother, Senator Anyim Ude, was a very great son from Ebonyi State. During his own time, he contributed immensely in his own profession. We thank God for his life and the entire family. Though he's a very big loss, but God knows the best. We still ask the family and the entire people of, especially Ebonyi State, to take heart. There is nothing we can do than to thank God Almighty. But as far as the family and the entire Ebonyi State are concerned, just have it in mind that we are with you anytime, any day. On behalf of my boss, Right Honorable Ogbonia Mwifuru, the governor of Ebonyi State, is here present in this occasion. I appreciate you all. Let me come to our chief speaker that taught us a lot of things today. You have really embroidered our wisdom and knowledge. I really appreciate you, sir. And today, for coming here, is a great day for me and my other colleagues that came here with me, because we have picked a lot of things. Your lecture was full of great compendium of wisdom. I thank you, sir. It shall be well with you. And for me, I will not leave you to go, because when you came here, you spoke my language. I will retaliate by telling you, Eshegun, Esha Adupe, Edema Adele Layo at Alafia. That is one Nigeria for you. Anytime, any day, we are one family. Esha Adupe, Adele Layo at Alafia. God bless everyone for coming here, and I know our good God will see us through and send us home to our various destination safely. I appreciate you all. God bless you.
Mikunuku Sieliaka, Her Excellency Princess Obila. Thank you very much. Oka di kwegu ma woka bi asuchala anyi igbo nwere enwe ike igwe na anyi nanu ihe nkeli bi ana asu biko dalu. Well, it is my pleasure to members of the audience, the exit of the governor of Ebonyi State does not mark the end of the program. Please sit wherever you are when she leaves, because the program will continue. Yes. Okay. Get ready. Okay, hold on. Okay, thank you very much. We're happy we have... Thank you. We have a very patient governor. The women are not to be blamed for the woes of Nigeria. Hello, Nasno, no more. I put on your chief at him. Unquona, why be if you're not saying if I can why you boo? Why you be fair? Ogo Silia Keta, no, Dalun. Because let me invite the next speaker who have been here since yesterday. Our own brother, our own friend, the chairman, chief executive officer of the Nigerian Economic Summit Group, to come and say one or two things, talking about Mr. Laoye Jayola. Laoye, you're welcome, sir. Bikunu call me aka. Kusiediko. Thank you, sir.
Your Excellency, the chairman of the occasion, the guest speaker, the IMD family, good afternoon. I want to appreciate the NUG for putting together. All of you told you about why I'm here. I'm here because Nana Ude is a board member of the NESG. Although he's my bro. And so I read the tributes on behalf of the Nigerian Economic Summit Group. And I'll read it so that I don't deviate from what they've asked me to say. Tribute to late Senator Ayim Chuku De M.O.N. The passage of Senator Elder Ayim Chuku De M.O.N. signals the exit of another national treasure of inestimable value. His unwavering commitment to reporting the news and current affairs of the Nigerian state was unparalleled, and his quest for reforms in the broadcasting industry as a veteran journalist, broadcaster, and administrator with vast experience in public service spanning over four decades, especially in media matters, made him an asset in all national discourse that he engaged in. Within the Nigerian Economic Summit Group, our country's longest standing public-private dialogue platform, Senator Ude was a guiding light for many aspiring public administrators and journalists alike. Regarding how to engage the Nigerian reform project in advancing public interest, his wisdom, mentorship, and unwavering commitment to truth and integrity nurtured a new generation of talents, shaping the future of journalism with invaluable insight. His mark on newsroom and public discourse space will forever be cherished and remembered. When he assumed the office of senator for the Ebonyi State constituency of Ebonyi State, he was one of the pioneer leaders of the legislative arm of government that sought engagement and leverage and mobilize the Nigerian Economic Summit Group platform. As a matter of fact, if you enter into the NESG building, you will see his picture and that of the founder of the NESG, the late Chief Ernest Shunekon, just there.
So it's not he wasn't there because of Nana. But he got there because of his relationship with the NESG and his contribution to the work we both doing nation building. You know, as a member, a credible member of his involvement in the federal transportation and markets will be remembered. He was put in the transport subcommittee, he was in the market subcommittee, and all of this will leverage in ensuring that we as the NESG did the work we needed to do. As a matter of fact, each time we needed a friend around legislature, he was ever there. We will miss him. So he was to us a grandmaster of public dialogue. He had left an indelible mark, an example of how public leaders must engage the polity and how national conversation can shape cohesiveness, prosperity, and progress. You know, he all made an affair of reading whatever we did as NESG already. And sometimes when I run into some little issues, through Nana, I always reach out to him to ask, well, what should I have done differently? And he was always there. So on behalf of the board, management and staff, and members of the Nigerian Economic Summit Group, we want to convey our deepest condolences to the Ayomide family and to the Ebonyi State people at large and to Nigeria. And our prayers is that the Lord will grant his soul the rest, and he will comfort the family, and the values he's left behind will not suffer loss in our hands. Thank you, and God bless you.
Thank you, sir. Well done. Well spoken. Before I call the next speaker, I'd like to recognize some distinguished men and women who are here. Honestly, there are so many distinguished persons that we failed to recognize. Let me recognize a former Minister of Health who is here in our midst, Chief Fidelis Nwankwo. Chief Fidelis Nwankwo, former Minister of Health, Nwankwo, so much humility in you, we appreciate you. We also know that there's Chief Dave Nwachukwu in our midst, a renowned banker. We know also that we have Abia Onyike, veteran journalist, communication expert. There is Chief Emeko Nyeso, Chief Emeko Nyeso, Larry Winiwu, Dennis Sabo, so many distinguished persons here. So many. None, Dalunu. I want to call quickly. I've just been told that an old boy of my school is here. A former president of this club, a lawyer of repute, Chief Ben Etiaba. Am I correct? Ben Anuma Fuzikwegi. Aha! Dalurinne, you're welcome, sir. Let me quickly invite Professor Elochukwu Amuchazi. Professor Elochukwu Amuchazi is... Yes. Before the speech that we are going to get from the Secretary of Igbo Leaders of Thought, talking about former DG of MAMSA, let me also recognize in a special way Chief Alex Chidozie Obonia, National Publicity Secretary, Ohanaeze Ndigbo Worldwide. Ekenengi, erudite scholar, Ojena Nwayo, Nukumado, Professor Muchazi, sir.
Thank you. I salute the chairman of this occasion, Chief Nyanwodo, and our distinguished visiting lecturer, the chairman, National Chairman Venuj. All protocols duly observed. This is not a pleasant event. The death of Senator Anyimude is a big blow on all of us. I'm speaking as the Secretary of Igbo Leaders of Thought, because the Secretary to the government is gone. I'm not a barrister. It's my son who is a barrister. I'm a professor of political science, not law. We had a meeting early in March, the planning committee of Igbo Leaders of Thought. And he wasn't there, so I phoned him. He told me, look, I'm not in Ebonyi. I'm somewhere else. I'll reach you when I come back. The next message I had was about his death. It's just a pity. We knew him very well. In fact, Igbo Leaders of Thought, we lost a lot of people over the past 1 year. Mbazilike Amoichi, His Royal Majesty, Vincent Ike. We have Dr. Chukwu Ogbu. We have Chief Chiwenite Ejike, Enechi Onye, Anikwenwa, the Archbishop of Province of Niger, and Anyimude. It's a great pity for us. I'm sure I accept your condolences. We were with Anyimude for some years. I'm sure probably no circumstances for the formation of Igbo Leaders of Thought. We've done a lot of things behind the scene. You can give this to chairman and the guest speaker. And the governor. Give this to the governor of Abia. These are just a few of what we've published. Never mind, it has Professor Nwabeze. But I can tell you, Anyimude was involved in all these things. This is just one of them. We did recognize the powerful barons in Senate, and we tried to reach them. There were some distinguished Igbo leaders. We tried to reach them behind the scene to see what can be done. The guest lecturer, not many know him. Before that, even Nyanwood, some people still call him John Nyanwood. He has dropped John, I can tell you this. Doesn't drive it, all these things. Sin Nyanwood. When you talk about people in Enugu State, I was watching him. Now we were trying to see who will break the cola knot. I was watching. He didn't make a mistake. I was watching. Who and who are in Enugu State? I would have told the governor to appreciate that Enugu was, is, and will remain the state, the capital of former Eastern Region. It's expanding. They are having estates and it's expanding and people are coming. It should remain. It's not a question of saying you are not an indigenous of any good state. It's a bit of rubbish talking about that kind of thing. Nia came from, his wife is from Abagana. My wife is also from Abagana. I can tell you this. From two notable barons in Abagana, founders of Abagana. When he was appointed the commissioner, he came to my house. We broke all or not. We went to his house. He brought and said I should split it. I said, why? A whole commissioner, I, as a small common man, to split the coal or not. He told me, look, do you know the problems in our bag and now? What do we do to resolve it? He said, look, we have stake to do this. You don't know who he is. The other day I was asking him, because he impressed the leaders, have they given you the station wagon or the vehicle they said they will give to him? He kept quiet. I think it's good for our governors to appreciate that they have challenges. Please, this is Eastern Nigeria. We've been tortured. Chinua wrote a book, The Trouble with Nigeria is with the Leadership. There's no way. You cannot give what you don't have. And you should be courageous enough. So it's not after 1 year or 2 years as a chairman, you withdraw. It's not enough. You sustain the battle. The Apatas, the first person, Olu Apata, was my colleague at Ibadan. Very fortunate. I think a university has been built and named after him, or College of Education. And the other person, I next somebody, always on bow tie. I know him. The young man is like, is that the son? Is that so? That's impressive. He's fatter than his uncle or something. Yes. But you people have done very well. But the challenge is still on leadership. And leadership doesn't mean people who are holding power. All of us are involved in this. You don't withdraw. You sustain the fight. And this is the only way. NUJ, you've done very well to have gathered these people. National. And these people coming, the other person coming from Abuja. And this. This is the capital of former Eastern region. It's still the capital of South East and South South. And they have all come. Look at how many people are here. I congratulate you people. You've done very well. If anyone got something here without reckoning with Nyanwood, then the person should think again. If you are doing something now and we don't invite this young man, look, when I say young man, I mean it. I'm advanced in age, you know. I don't think I'm just because I'm lean. I'm lean because I've seized all our sources of resources, so I cannot feed myself again. That's that. So we thank you people, the Anyim family. It's a great loss for your father. It's a great loss. We are missing him, not just you. Done very well, very quiet. We, Igbo leaders of thought, I led the delegation to see your governor. It was not easy convincing him to talk to him. He wasn't involved in controversies. Eventually he did. And I led a 5-man delegation. We spent a night with him. We saw it and talked with him. But of course, I mean, after you've talked to somebody, he has his own orientation about life. And these are some of the things they're doing. And it's not acceptable to us. Look, so look, every person is not acceptable to us. Igbos have a challenge, and I can show you these problems and others will come out of it. We will, by God's grace. Amen. I thank the Ebonyi. You have a new challenge. Please remember, we're all part of Ndigbo. You know, our people are being insulted all over this country. We don't have amenities, don't have facilities. I mean, look at Onitsha, Owerri Road, Onitsha, Enugu Road, no railways, Oji Power Station and the rest of them. Nothing has happened. And you think we are just smiling. I thank all of you for what you are doing. I thank the family there to it and all these distinguished people. Thank you so much. Wish you well.
Thank you, Prof. Thank you, Prof. Quickly, let me invite the last speaker before the family will respond. Let me call the Ozowara himself. Ozowara Chief Obonia. That is Chidozie. Alex, my brother, National Publicity Secretary, Ohaneze Nibo Worldwide, Ozorona, to make a few remarks, just a few remarks, because Olumide Apata is about catching his flight. Thank you so much.
Okay, I'll be very, very brief. But before I must have to salute the chairman of this occasion, Ikukehe. He was my principal. He was the president of Ohaneze Nibo Worldwide while I was the president of Ohaneze Nibo in Enugu State. I also salute Chief, he said Mr., but I say Chief Ulu Apata. When he was contesting for president of Nigerian Bar Association, I told one of the lawyers around that, but he's not a son. He's not a senior member of, San. But it wasn't San. And how could he win when he wasn't San? He told me there's something more in Olu than being a San. Yes, and I'm very happy that he impressed everybody here. Yes, thank you. So, Your Excellency, I salute you, and please let me stand on the existing protocol. Somebody said to do the vote of thanks, but let me use this privilege of being here to do the vote of thanks on behalf of Ohaneze Nibo Worldwide. Because Olu coming from all the way, and all everybody's in here, Ohaneze had lost an icon. Ohaneze Nibo had lost an important personality. If you look at the profile, you see that somebody who had been very ingenious through his lifetime, and also contributed to the growth of this country. But I'm happy that the son, there was one event here. I saw the son collaborating with the son of Chukwumerije in one event here. I said, yes, these are our bigger brothers are handing over the relay baton. Because in relay race, at a point, you hand over to somebody to take it on. So I'm very much impressed about you, the younger Ayimude. Keep it up, and my condolences, or the condolences of Ohaneze Nibo, to the family, immediate family, and also to the people of Ebonyi State. Before ending, I will also add that I didn't really relate with the senator very closely, but the important thing is that I used to see him at Ohaneze meetings, taking active part in Ohaneze activities, but now that he's going, meeting our ancestors, the message I want to see if he can deliver to our people who are already there, like Isaac Iwe, Emoy Okpara, and the rest of them. When he goes, Senator, tell them that things are no longer as they expected. Tell them, I wanted to buy fuel yesterday. They say it was, the other day it was 600. Yesterday it was 700. And some other place, 800. Tell them that things are falling apart. That the Falcon can no longer hear the Falconer. Tell them that at election, the accredited voters, at the end of election, the voters are more than the accredited voters. Tell them that even the journalists, well, Azikiwe was a true journalist because there was investigative journalism. But tell them that these days it is full of fake news. You don't know the one to believe. It was only yesterday I read that there is a second Biafran war, and the soldiers should be deployed to the southeast. And journalists carried it. Tell them that even journalists themselves do not have a way of controlling their members. Tell them that things are falling apart that center cannot hold. Tell them that during the war is even better because you know the enemy camp and you know from where the bullet is coming. But today you don't even know from where the bullet is coming. You don't know where to go from here. Tell them that we are all in trouble. That every day we expect a change of leadership. They tell us a story that things will change and the things will change worse. Tell them that we are survival battle, but I don't know where this one we are facing now will take us. Tell them we are all in trouble. Senator, wherever you go, may your soul rest in peace. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Osorona. Tony Osorona. When Osawara was speaking, I was just watching Ndienwodo. You know the way a father feels when a son is doing very well. He was elated, and I'm sure he's still beaming with smiles. Otherwise, just electrify the environment, and we are very proud of you. Thank you very much. It is at this juncture that I'd like to humbly welcome one of the Uday's family, in fact, his son, Nana, very handsome, very everything, shy but son.
First of all, let me express our appreciation to His Excellency, the Governor of Ebonyi State, for honoring us with his presence through the Deputy Governor, Her Excellency, Princess Patricia Obiora. Thank you so much, Her Excellency. I also want to thank the Governor of Enugu State for honoring us with his presence by asking the Secretary of the State Government to honor us with his own presence. And then, of course, to our father, Chief Nia Ngodu. When I called him to talk about this event, he said, before I mentioned the date, he said, I'll be there. And I was trying to get an appointment to bring a letter to him. He said, you can keep the letter, I will be there. Thank you so much, sir. And then my Ebo Olumide Akpata, like you said, we've come a long way, and I appreciate our relationship greatly. What you have done today will never, ever, ever leave my memory. Thank you so much. Whenever you are honored by your own people, you know it's special. My father had many addresses as a community leader, as an administrator, as a public servant, as a technocrat. But his primary address was journalism. And so I thank the NUJ for putting this event together to bring him home to his primary address. My father loved journalism. It was in his blood, and he practiced it to the end. Even with the transition from traditional to digital media. Sometimes he shares the news with me before I even get to know what's happening. And I always ask him, Daddy, how did you get this before me? He said, that's why I'm a veteran journalist. It was so much a part of him that there is something I haven't said to anybody, even my siblings. And they're going to hear it for the first time. My father became a journalist on the day he was employed as a reporter. He started work in October 1960 as a finance clerk here in Enugu. And he said, because he hated the whole idea of dressing up in white shirt and white shorts and chasing people around for their taxes, he didn't want to do that work. And then he found his calling in journalism. And he was employed as a journalist on May 15, 1965. And he passed away on May 15, 2023. So, because of his dedication to the profession, our family, in consultation with the NUJ, through the Senator Anyimude Foundation, will institute an annual Anyimude Prize for Investigative Journalism, with a prize money of 1 million naira every year to a journalist that will distinguish himself or herself as determined by the NUJ in the area of investigative journalism to honor his memory, because those who knew him when he practiced journalism knew that my father would go to any length to get the truth of the story. And so we deem it very important to institutionalize that part of him and honor journalists from next year. The NUJ will set up the committee that will determine the criteria, and once a winner is announced, the family will present a prize money of 1 million naira to the winner every year. Before I step down, I also want to thank Ulu in a special way from the family. And so I want to invite my elder sister, Nina, to present a plaque of appreciation to Ulu for delivering this memorial lecture. Thank you so much, Ulu. And thank you so much, everyone. Thank you. I'm sure wherever he is, my dad will be smiling. And we all pray for the peaceful repose of his soul in Jesus' name.
Biko nukonu na aka. Let me recognize, before we end this program, one of Aimude's daughter, Mrs. Ngozi Ndukwe, Senior Librarian, Energy Commission, Abuja, who came here with the daughter. Please, can you stand up for recognition? Even the daughter, I was thinking they are sisters. Dalurinde, thank you very much, Ngozi Ndukwe. I'm going to invite somebody who Aimude loves so much to say the closing prayer. I say it because I do know that one that biting journalist, good writer, became 50. I was privileged to be in that program here in Enugu when Aimude came to pay him honor. It is my pleasure to bring to the podium to say the closing prayer, Nze Magnus Eze, who is the bureau chief of the Sun newspapers here in the southeast. Nze.
Shall we pray? In Jesus' name. Amen. The mighty name of Jesus Christ. Father, we thank you for a day like this. We give you honor. We give you glory. We give you adoration. Father, we thank you because you've really honored us. We've come from far and near to honor one of our own. Father, you edified the whole situation by giving us a clement weather. Father, you've made everything go seamless. And we say, may your name be highly exalted. Father, one of us is gone. His soul is departed. One very dear to us, our father, our mentor, our guardian, our instructor. Father, let him rest in peace in Jesus' name. Amen. Lord, thank you for all you have brought from far and near. Father, as we depart, may your glory be with us. Father, we ask that as other activities regarding this funeral that will culminate in the interment on Friday, as they come by, Lord, we say, let them be successful so that at the end we'll have cause to glorify your name. Thank you, Father, for prayers answered. For your mighty name of Jesus Christ we have prayed. Thank you.
National anthem. May we be upstanding, please.